can fly. I am known by the name of Irene Moss Gravenhorst, spelled capital I, small R-E-N-E, dash capital M, small A-U-S, colon, meaning belonging to the family clan Gravenhorst, spelled capital G, small R-A-V-E-N-H-O-R-S-T, trademark, author, agent, creditor of the copyright trademark name claim, known by name as I am Gravenhorst or any other derivative thereof in any style of cause, and I claim common law jurisdiction with equitable remedy by estoppel. That's who I am!
Okay, so to a person who just went, what does that mean? How would you explain that to them?
Okay, well, in this world of commerce and illusionary money and the monopoly game, what the bankers and the gangsters have done is basically created a fiction name, which is your capitalized name. And that is all entered into court documents. That's all your government ID, your passport, your medical plan, your insurance, your car ownership, just any kind of a government-issued ID. Even your Canadian citizenship, which is really important, your birth certificate. What they did then in those days, 1867, is when Her Majesty the Queen in Right of Canada decided to claim a bonded value to your name. So instead of calling you a creditor, they called you a debtor. But they didn't tell you about the illusion that they created. And now the illusion is starting to fade away because people are starting to understand the truth. I became involved with my position to go against the bankers and the gangsters in 2001 after a divorce from hell that took 5 years to resolve, and it cost me $130,000 in legal fees and disbursements. So I thought it was noticeable enough for me to kind of pursue, like, what's going on with this picture? This doesn't seem right. I was with this man for 17 years, multi-million dollar resort business, and all I got was a home, little tiny settlement for 3 years of payments, and that was basically it. Oh, and I got a car. I was really lucky to get a car. So CCRA came after me right after the settlement was produced by my lawyers. And they decided to assess me for a motor vehicle tax assessment for the years 1996 and 1997 for approximately $14,000. So I appeared as a self-litigant to appeal the decision that they had made to assess me with, and stood before Judge R.W. Rowe on January 2002. I won the appeal, as the judge ruled in my favor, for the tax returns for those 2 years were never signed by me. There was no contract, right? If you don't sign the contract, it has no force or effect. So the company who leased the vehicle hired an accountant to do the tax returns and simply didn't supply the tax department with enough information, which is why they went after me. The judge rendered a judgment that allowed my appeal, and the tax department had to review this claim to assess the company. But instead of pursuing the claim with the company, CCRA deliberately ignored the judgment, went right over a judge's decision, and came again after me in the fall of the year 2002 and garnished my bank account with HSBC. Now, I happen to know that HSBC is in contract with the IRS, because I got a letter from HSBC stating that they had to do a reporting to the IRS, and I said, no, you're not in Canadian jurisdiction, so I don't know why you would think that you have a right to do this, so I don't agree with this. But so things were already getting hot at that bank, and so I decided to move my mortgage. And I decided that because I'm spirit-driven on this mission of freedom, the teller at HSBC, when Revenue Canada garnished the bank account, she looked me straight in my eyes and she handed over my $7,000 deposit and she said, take the money and run, right? So I took that as a really powerful message. The universe was speaking to me. And I met with the vice president of HSBC and basically told him in a private meeting that I felt raped by this garnishment. And he said, you know what, I understand your position and you have full legal recourse to fight CCRA. And then he showed me a paper clipping, a newspaper clipping of where he had gone and fought over something that he thought was unjust. And it took him many, many years to earn him millions of dollars in a settlement, but he only got a fraction of it because it all went to legal fees. I chalked this up as a lesson and decided to close my mortgage with HSBC and went to a mortgage broker. And that was a really interesting experience because first thing he said is, I have to have your social insurance number. And I said, no, you're not getting it. And he said, why? I said, because Revenue Canada has nothing to do with this transaction. This is a transaction between you and me. If Revenue Canada wants to get involved, why aren't they here sitting in this transaction with me? You know? So no, I'm not allowing them to be involved in this transaction and I will not submit my social insurance number. He says, well, it's highly unusual. I have to do a credit check on you. And I said, well, you've got enough. You've got my, I'm giving you my a copy of my state of title certificate and all that kind of stuff. Anyway, the North Shore Credit Union picked up the mortgage. And at the time of the mortgage, the transfer was signed, the bank representative crossed out all of the third-party references because I told her, I said to her, I can't sign these documents because you've got the social insurance number on there. How did it get on there? I said, I specifically told the mortgage broker that it's not supposed to be involved because it's third-party and they do not have my permission. So on assumption and presumption, how did you get it on there? And she said, well, it's done automatically. And I said, well, I can't sign the documents. I can't sign the mortgage documents because then I'd be committing fraud. And I won't commit fraud. I don't want to commit fraud or perjury. So we named my daughter as a power of attorney to the account because she has a different name. And I thought that that would double the protection. No SIN number and having somebody else also be a holder to the account. Wrong! Totally wrong. That didn't work. In January 2005, I returned my social insurance number to CCRA by registered notice to break the tax contracts, and since then I've been billing them for copyright trademark name infringements, and so currently CCRA owes me trillions of dollars in contractual obligations as the named debtors to the account with me. I also placed the North Shore Credit Union on notice and started asking questions about the allodial, or the deed to the land, because you figure that if somebody's going to get financing, they're going to hold something in trust for you until you have paid the account in full and then your deed is returned to you. But instead of responding to my questions, they sent lawyers after me. I also defined the lawyers who were coming after me as third-party interveners and warned them about my copyright trademark name. And if they produced any more documentation, then they would be charged with a $3 million debt per infringement.
Can you talk about the user agreement and
Yes, the user agreement is something that goes is dovetailed. I work with like a wings of a dove. So you send in a registered notice letting them know that you've copyrighted your name. And the user agreement comes with a whole bunch of terms and conditions as to who gets penalized and what you're penalizing.